So today we can start to look at abstract vector space. We've looked a lot at vector space already, in particular at the geometrical arrow. We said that this is something with which you are familiar from your previous school encounters with this notion of vector, which is basically something which has both a length, a magnitude, and a direction. But we already raised your attention to the fact that there could be the abstract vectors in the sense that they belong to the n-dimensional space, in which case we would write them with this bold letter with n coordinates, n component. And this already, it's difficult to speak of a direction, because where is it pointing in the space of n dimension is something we cannot visualize so clearly. So it's a bit more complicated. But we could speak of things like their length or size or things like this. And this is actually what we are going to focus on in this first lecture, the notion of the length of a vector, but of a vector in an abstract space, and more abstract even than this nth dimensional space. So actually, our first novelty, the first important thing that we will do, is something really simple, because it's a convention, it's a terminology, it's a notation, is to introduce a new way to write the vectors, which will not be with this bold letter, or to put the arrow. Of course, the arrow is really to refer to the geometric object. We are going to introduce this new notation where we put the vector, the abstract vector u, it remains to be defined what we mean by abstract vector, the lecture is about that. We put it into this strange construct where we've got a vertical line like this, and then a sort of a superior or equal sign. It's not precisely this sign, it's, if we typeset it correctly, it looks like this, like what we have on the screen now. And this we will call a ket. So this notation comes from an important physicist of the 20th century, which is called Paul Adrian Maurice, that's the full list of first name. Dirac is the one who brought together special relativity and quantum mechanics. So special relativity, we might know that it's the business of Einstein, and quantum mechanics, you have heard certainly, there are much more many people associated to that, but we can name people like Schrödinger or Heisenberg and others in their wake, but they are the main people. And one described the things that go very fast, that's relativity, the other described the things that are really small, atomic objects, that's quantum mechanics. But things that are both small and fast, well, they have been first brought together by this person, Dirac, and to do that, in quantum mechanics, he introduced this beautiful notation of the bra, that we haven't seen yet, coming in a little while, and ket vector. So that's really the way to point that it is abstract. In which sense? Because we can speak of something like that, for instance, this concept that comes from Schrödinger, this one. Schrödinger, he was so surprised by the consequences of the theory that he took as an example to illustrate how absurd the theory looked to him. He took this example of a cat that could be in this state. I have to draw it to the best of my ability. So that's a cat which is alive. And he said that he could make a superposition. So superposition, it means the sum with the cat that is dead, like this. So that's my drawing. I'll put on the screen a better drawing of this concept. And we speak in this way of, so there is a square root of 2, as you have seen. You'll understand in the exercises, if you are daring enough to try to tackle the exercise, why there is a square root of 2. The point is that this makes a meaningful thing, which is the, I don't know how to draw it myself, the cat which is both died, alive and dead at the same time. We call that a Schrödinger cat. It's a superposition of two state of a system that are completely orthogonal. We come back to this concept that we have already discussed of orthogonality, in the sense of they don't see each other, they're not compatible, they are opposite, so to speak. As you can imagine, for a cat to be alive and dead are the two most different types of things that the cat can do. And I give you this example to bring your attention that however the object, however abstract indeed the concept is, it's not abstract, a dead cat or a cat which is not dead, an alive cat. It's not abstract per se, it's not abstract in nature, it's not abstract when it's in the backyard. But when it's on the piece of paper and we add this and we divide by square root of 2, it starts to become really abstract. What do we mean exactly by this object? Okay, so the point is that that's what it means to be abstract. We don't care too much about what is really at the end, at the bottom of this object, yeah, what it means really to be that. We see other examples in quantum mechanics like the atomic wave functions. Yeah, so you could say that this is an helium atom, for instance, like this with two electrons. Okay, so we put this in this ket to mean that, I don't know if I'm drawing to try to be maybe evocative, we put it in a ket to mean that it's not a number, it's not even a geometrical vector, or it's not a simple n-dimensional vector, abstract, complicated vector in the sense of it's a list of n numbers. It could be something really complicated. Yeah, it's something abstract by definition is, we imagine it could be whatever we want. The point is, it still satisfies some rule. It still obeys to some algebra. The algebra that defines the space where these vectors live. So that's a vector space. Okay, so a vector space, it's a space where we can define this kind of highly conceptually involved sophisticated object, a cat or things like this. And then you can make simple algebraic operation to them, like adding them, scaling them, and that gives rise to other concepts. So we'll see in quantum mechanics that this, precisely this type of things, they have a meaning. They describe the reality, the physical reality. So we leave it to quantum mechanics to explain what it means exactly, this cat state, the interpretation, yeah, which is a beautiful thing, is the principle of linear superposition of quantum mechanics. Some people got the Nobel Prize for that, to make in the laboratory these kind of things. What we will do, us, in the course of physics, is to start to introduce the mathematical apparatus or techniques or the way the rules to deal with this object, with these abstract vectors. Okay, so we are trying now to get used with the things that are familiar, which is the operations themselves, the algebraic operations. So with this we are familiar, we try to get used to applying them to objects that are much more abstract. Again, I'm using over and over the same name because this is what this is about, yeah? Abstract vector space. Okay, so as I said, we will worry particularly on the notion of the length or the size of this vector. Because all vectors, whether they are abstract or not, like I will take again these two cases of my U, which is geometrical, or my U, which lives in this n-dimensional vector space, or my cat state. So I will not, from now on, I will not write the cat all the time because it's clumsy to draw. Of course, it's not nice. We do it to illustrate the point, but at the end, we always put simply a letter to label the state. Even though it's a cat state, whatever it is, even if it's a complicated object and not a number, we'll still use a single letter to capture the state as a whole. So all these different vectors, all these different objects, they share common properties. Like they can be added, they can be scaled, and we can speak of their length. So let me remind you what is the length for geometrical arrow. This was the square root of the scalar product of the thing with itself, right? Because you remember by the rules of the scalar product, so that would be the same, we could write it like this actually, for this abstract space, that would be the square root of U scalar product with itself. So the scalar product was the sum of the pairwise components, pairwise product of components. So it's ui square for y goes from 1 to n. So in the case of a three-dimensional space, if I call x, y, z the component of my vector u, which would make sense for a geometrical vector in real space, that becomes x square plus y square plus z square. Square root of this is Pythagoras' theorem, yeah? Pythagoras' length of in 2D, you see that this is the xy, this is the length of this thing, yeah, by the Pythagoras theorem, in fact, the square root. So that makes good sense. So how would we define this for the abstract vector psi? So the first thing to do is to realize that one nice way to write this this vector there, it's indeed to make this scalar product, to understand that this scalar product, u, scalar product with itself, I will write it like this. I will say that this is a product, normal product, or I will call it table product, because I will put this in table form. So I'm taking the transpose first, and I multiply by u. So that's the second u. I will put some letters. That's this u, and that's the first u here, which I transpose. Transpose, it means that my column vector in n dimension, I put it on the horizontal line. So I've got now the u1, un component, and here u1, un. So we could speak of a table product because this is kind of a table. It's a 1 times n table. It has 1 row n column, and here this is n times 1 table with n rows and 1 column. So we don't call that table. There is a special name for that we will introduce later on in the course. Again, this is called a matrix. So we speak of matrix products. So the way the matrix products work is that we run horizontally there and we match it vertically there. Okay, so if I would take again another color, the U1 goes with the U1. I will put another component, the second one, U2, U2. They also match together, the U2 goes to the U2, till the end, like this, we do it. So they have to get the same dimension, we need N columns and N row there, so that each element there has an element there to be paired with, and we make the sum of all this. Yeah, so that's UI, UI, I equal 1 to N, in terms of the color, that's here and here. Okay? Actually, so far, we are working in real space. We could work as well in n-dimensional complex space, in which case when we go from the row to the column we use this symbol. This symbol is to mean that we take the transpose is mean we interchange the columns and the rows, and we take the complex conjugate as well, two operations for which we take this dagger, to mean that we are doing two things. In which case, the green, they come with the little star here. UI, star, UI. The star reminding us that we are working in the space of horizontal table. Because it's real here, we don't have these stars. But you can remember that it's there for when we are going to turn to complex valued, abstract vector space. The space of quantum mechanics are usually complex valued. Okay, very good. So, that's a way to get the notion of the length of our vector. Yeah, we could say that the length of our vector is the square root of this UU as before, which is also U transpose U table or matrix product. Table would be a good name because here we are working with vectors, but we could literally work with real tables where we have not 1 times n but n times m. We'll see that later. So let's come back to our abstract object, and we'll take the first example of an abstract object. We'll take a function, for instance. Yeah? So we'll take, for instance, the sine functions. We like very much to work with the sine functions always, the sine and cosine functions. So here, to make the transition smooth, to start to work with abstract vector, not in the completely unfamiliar and foreign and alien environment, but to link it with things we know, we are going to use a nice trick which is called discretization, which means that our function, I will write it like this, the sine function, I will actually not take the real exact function which is defined on some interval, I don't know, minus pi pi, with an aleph node here, a continuous set of points, so that will be really an object by itself, the sine function. I'm going to take an n-dimensional vector in which I'm sampling the values of my function on this mesh of points, on this grid of points. Yeah. So instead of having a continuous function, which I would not even know how to write, maybe I would have to draw it, so I would have to do things like this, yeah, to say that this is the sine function, and then there is the cosine function. What would be the cosine function? It would be something like this, maybe. So I would have to write it like this. So it's not very agreeable, right? I would really have to give the plot all the time. Yeah, so that would be maybe a bit unfamiliar. So before we get there to work with exactly abstract functions, we're going to work with things that are familiar, the n-dimensional discretized version. So we'll have to work with a particular case. To keep things simple, we'll work on a grid which has a mesh separated by integer. Yeah, so we're going to take things like this. This is 0, 1, 2, 3. My grid is defined by the integer, right? And we'll go negative because we want to work with symmetric functions. So that's my grid. That's my grid there. Line it a little bit. I do it as well for the negative part. And because I want to work with functions that are symmetric and that have nice ending, they don't stop randomly, as well to take a function that has sufficient enough of repetition that we can recognize what it is, I'll take, for instance, the sine pi over 6x, and I will work from minus 24 to 24. In this case, the 24 times pi over 6 is 12 divided by 3, that's 4 pi, yeah, the sine of 4 pi. So that's pi, 2 pi, 3 pi, 4 pi. The sine is 0. So the function will stop there at 0, it will stop at 0, and it will repeat a given amount of time. We are making as I said, so one rotation does 2π, 4π, it's making it twice. So if I try to draw this, it will be something like this. We'll take values, up, 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 then you will stop there when I've got this ellipsis. So I'm not drawing it exactly. I'm putting on the screen the exact drawing there, then there is the ellipsis there. And at the end, on the grid of the final point, I'm not plotting what happens in the ellipsis, it's finishing. For 4π, it's coming from below, so it will finish like this, the curve, okay? So, and it goes, it's symmetric like this as well, and it will go from minus 24, I think, from above, something like this. So we are replacing our exact function, which is infinite continuous function. We are replacing it by this sampled discretized version, where I'm looking at the value of the function when it is intercepted by the grid. Okay, so we have to look at the values, which are the values we can compute them. I will write this vector like this. I will write it sine. I will put a pi over 6 here to remember ourselves that we are having this modulation. And I'm not putting in the vector, so it's kind of assumed that the functions live in the space of minus 24, 24. So let's look at the various cases which we have. The smallest one is 0, in which case, so that would be the central one here, 0, because here is minus 24, and here is 24. So here we've got, after 24 values, we are at 0. The sine of 0 is 0. The first one, the first element we've got on our grid, the first element here, that's the sine of pi over 6. So how do we find the sine of pi over 6? Pi over 6, since pi is 180 degrees, that's 30 degrees, right? That's 30 degrees. Okay, so we'll work first with the pi over 3. We are going to work that in steps, because pi over 3 is 60 degrees. 60 degrees, if you look at a triangle of 60 degrees, by definition, it's an equilateral triangle, because you know that the sum of all angles is equal to alpha, beta, and gamma, is equal to 180, or pi, is pi, 180. And if alpha is equal to gamma is equal to beta, then they are all equal to pi divided by 3 by definition. And pi divided by 3 is 60 degrees. So we've got 60 degrees, 60 degrees, 60 degrees. Now if we put this in the trigonometric circle, which means that the equilateral triangle has the length 1, the radius 1. So let's draw the trigonometric circle which intercepts this triangle. Now we see that we've got indeed here this distance, that's the projection there, is the sine of pi over this angle, pi over 6, the quantity we are looking for, because that's 30 degrees. If the full angle here is 60 degrees, half of this angle, because we are looking at the top part of the circle, is 1/2 of pi over 3, which is pi over 6. And this is equal to 1/2, right, by definition, because this is 1. This is 1 because this is an equilateral triangle, and this is half 1, so 1/2. Okay. So we've got our first result, that sine of pi over 6 is 1/2. So here we'll put 1/2. That's the value of my discretized vector, of my abstract vector that defines this function sine pi over 6. Now here, on the second point on the grid, we've got sine 2 pi over 6 is sine pi over 3. So that's pi over 3 here, pi over 6. So sine pi over 6, actually, this is the sine, sine pi over 3, sine pi over 3, this is the sine of 60 degrees, and the sine of 60 degrees, we've got it there. If you look, let me put a different color. We've got it there, yeah, because that's the opposite divided by the radius, the hypotenuse, yeah. So what is this quantity here in this same triangle? This quantity, given that I know the red one, which is 1/2, I can work with this one by Pythagoras. We've got 1/4 plus the unknown quantity. This unknown quantity is the sine of pi over 3 square is equal to Pythagoras r square, which is 1, is equal to 1. Okay, so we've got the sine of pi over 3 is the square root of 1 minus 1 fourth. 1 minus 1 fourth is 3 fourths. So this is square root of 3 divided by 2. Okay, so that's 3 square root of 2. Then the third point of our grid here. So that was the first, the second, the third point. It's not drawn correctly. This is highly schematic. That would be my third point, actually, because the third point is bring us here. Yeah, 1, 2, 3, we get there. The sign of this is very easy, is 1. And now they are all very easy because we just repeat. Yeah, the four, so 1, 2, 3, the fourth point. So that sign 4 pi over 3 is square root of 3 divided by 2 again by symmetry. And then we've got again 5 pi over 6, we've got again 1 half. And we carry on. Then we've got 0 because we are there. And then we have the same thing but negative. So we just extend, there my vector. So I've got all the negative value and all the positive values. So now we repeat. And of course, the 24 is not there, it's at the end, right? Let me move on this. My vector. Okay, so we repeat. We said we go negative now, so that's is it 7th pi over 3? No, that was 5, 6. 6 pi over 3. 6 pi over 3 is 2 pi, so it's not good. Ah, because it's over 6, sorry, over 6. Okay, 2 pi would be there. So that 7 pi over 6, the sign is by symmetry against the minus of this one. This one was 1 half, so we go minus 1 half. Then we go there, which is minus square root over 2. Then we go there, which is minus 1. We repeat again. We repeat again the symmetric one. So we are at minus square root 3 over 2, minus 1 half, 0. And then we start where we started. We did this 2. We are back at 0. And then we start again, so it's cyclic. So there, I repeat. Yeah, I'm at 0, I repeat this part there. Okay, I repeat it when, until I make 4 times, I go round 4 times, because I go till 24. And this is the same if I go negative as well. Yeah, if I go negative, we are minus 1 half, because that's this sign here, then we've got minus square root 3 over 2, minus 1, so on and so forth, until we finish at the top. So the top would be, if we start there, so that will start at 0, and we are getting from there, so that's minus, we said, minus 1 half, okay? So that's our, I zoom out, this big vector there, which you see on the screen, it is our sine pi over 6, our abstract vector, defined on 24 plus 24 plus 1, that is the 0, so that's 49 points. That's the size of our grid. So how do we measure something like, now we are coming to the point, how do we measure the scalar product of, oops, sorry, don't write with lipstick, how do we measure the length of this abstract vector like this? Yeah. So given that we discretize it, we know how to do it. It's just a particular case of this n-dimensional space. So we are going to look at the transpose and make the product, the table or matrix product with this transpose, or we could have said that this is the scalar product of this vector. Yeah. So I use different notation of the scalar product, or here, or of this matrix product we are transpose. We are going to use the first one, actually. They both work, but the first one is more elegant because we introduce a second notation. We say that the transpose, and again transpose because we are working with real value space. You see that all the values that I'm taking there are real because that's the sign. If we would be working with the complex conjugate, we would take the transpose and the star, which we would write collectively as this dagger. Okay, so this we introduce a new notation, which is like this. We simply reverse the order. So now our right angle becomes the left angle, and this line that encloses the thing that encapsulates the label that defines our abstract vector, it remains this, becomes this vertical size. And this Dirac calls a bra. We'll see why in a second or so. So now, if we come back here, we see that this becomes the sine pi over 6 bra times, so I don't need to put this. So I would put it like this, right? But to win time, because we already have something that encloses the quantity, we just remove one of them, or we merge it if you want, yeah, maybe more, even more accurately, we superimpose it. So we write it like this. That's the matrix product or table product as defined for the n-dimensional vector, one of which became a row when it was before a normal column vector. Okay, and we apply the definition that we know, which means that it will be, let's actually do it if you want. I want to copy it simply. It's something experimental. I never did it before in quite this form. We'll see how well it turns up. I want to see if I can maybe rotate this thing. Yeah. So I should rotate the number as well, because we write number. The proper way to write it would be to write like this: 0, minus 1. We don't put comma. We could, yeah, put the comma if you want, if it helps you. And then you've got, so if I start there, that's 1/2 square root of 3 over 2, 1 square root of 3 over 2, 1/2, so on and so forth. Okay, that's the good vector. And then we do this matrix product as we defined it, let's see in green. So we multiply this with this, then we will multiply the second component to the second component, and then we match them. We go like this and like this, and we make the sum. Okay, so this will be equal to 0 square plus minus 1/2 square plus, if we do the one in red, that would be 1/4 plus 3/4 plus 1. We do all this, yeah? That's the sine square. So I let you do that, and if you have the strength, or actually it's not difficult if you do it consistently, you keep track of the quantity you have. It's not so many of them that repeats. Do it as an exercise. You will find the result that you find for the sine, it's 24. Okay, so if we want the length, for the length we will take the square root of this, so the norm will be actually the square root. I forgot here to put the square, because that's the vector product, so we'll get the square root. So our length will get the square root for the sine pi over 6, it will be square root of 24. We could do the same, not for the sine, but for the cosine. I could take a different color in blue and look at the cosine. So the cosine will be a function like this. And we do the same. We look at where the function is intercepted by the grid. Yeah, and then it will come there, certainly, because they are perpendicular. So if it's 0 there, it will certainly be minus 1. Okay. Again, I put the exact drawing on the screen so that you can see the cosine. So we have the same idea. We have value for the cosine. We can look very quickly at the first element. They are very related. The cosine pi over 6. Let's look at the one of the at the center of the vector. So for 0, we've got 1. That's the cosine of 0, is this quantity. Then here, so the sine and cosine, they have this relationship, yeah, that the sine of an angle is the cosine of pi over 2 minus this angle, for the reason that we found in the equilateral triangle, yeah, the sine of this angle is the cosine of this angle. Okay, so if it was 1/2 here, it becomes square root of 3/2, then it becomes 1/2, then 0. So they are dephased, and the sine and cosine, they are the real function but dephased. And the same there, so it's minus square root 3/2, because we are there, minus 1/2, minus 1, so on and so forth. So we can look at something interesting as well, which is the scalar product of the cosine with the sine. So same story, we would have to make the product between this quantity and the central one. It cannot be 1, it has to start at a 0, yeah. The sine of 0 is 0. Then this 1 square root of 3/2 will go with the minus 1/2. So if we do this, it's easy as well if you do it consistently, but even if you give it a moment's thought to see are the blocks of this thing repeat, are they multiplied with the product, this time we can have cancellation of the sign. And we will find that at the end of the day, we will get the perfect zero, perfect cancellation. So here we've got this result again of two vectors, or two abstract, well, two n-dimensional vectors, u and v, that are zero. That are zero in the sense they are perpendicular, which means they point in directions that don't see each other. Yeah, there is an overlap, yeah, there is no overlap. So it's true as well for abstract functions, for a sine and cosine. You can say that the sine and cosine are perpendicular. That's interesting because on the trigonometric circle, they literally are perpendicular. Yeah, the sine is there, that's the sine, and the cosine is there, that's the cosine. So they are exactly perpendicular in the trigonometric circle. But they are also perpendicular in this more general sense, because we will see, starting in a couple of lectures, we will see that in which sense the polynomial can be orthogonal to another polynomial. Or we can see are the exponential orthogonal to another function. Our functions, in general, can be orthogonal, even though they are not defined as projections on the axis of a circle. So orthogonal, it means that they are looking in different directions. And this is a concept which is subtle, highly abstract as well, and that's why we are doing all this very slowly, because we start to develop an intuition of how to look at this thing, how to understand this thing. First intuition I could give you is that orthogonal, it means that one is probing a given characteristic or feature of the function, namely that it is an odd function, which is the case of the sine. You see that it's odd. The sine of minus x is minus the sine of x. Okay, that's the sine of minus x. And this is the sine, that's x, that's the sine of x. See that if the variable is opposite, then also the function is opposite. So it's odd function. While the cosine is the opposite, it is even. Yeah, the sine and cosine are the same. For the x and minus x are the same. So they are orthogonal in the sense that one is looking at the odd aspect and the other is looking at the even aspect. But they are also orthogonal or complementary or blind complementary in this way in other respects that we will come to when we look at Fourier series and these kind of things. Okay, we could as well, last thing that we do, which is the same idea, we look at the norm of the cosine. So like we did for the sine, but instead of taking the values of the sine, we are taking the value of the cosine. And we will find this time that this is not equal to square root of 24, it's equal to square root of 25. 24 is a strange number for the length of the cosine, but it's actually a familiar one in the context of this lecture, because we met this 24 before. That's the number of points we took in our grid. Yeah, it's 2 times 24 plus 1. So the cosine seems to be seeing a bit larger by 1 point, 1 unit of our grid more than the sine. It's 25 rather than 24. So why is it like this? Does it look true or correct that the sine and cosine should have different size? Because they really look like the same function. If you turn your trigonometric circle, your sine becomes a cosine. So they are really the same object, just with some dephasing, right? So they should have the same size, the same length, the same norm. That seems correct. So it's not surprising that it's different, because we are discretizing. Discretizing, it means we make a mistake. Yeah? In particular, you see that between these 2 points, between this point and this point here, between this point and this point, if I zoom, instead of having this nice curvature, what we would get at best is an interpolation, it's a straight line, right? So we are making a mistake. We are missing all the data there. We don't know exactly how the function, the sine, is curving. If it wouldn't be the sine and another function, it could even be do very complicated stuff like that. So there is a mistake due to the discretization. So to see the impact of this mistake, what we can do is to take a finer grid to make a better discretization, to sample more points. So we could take, for instance, twice the amount of points to look as well at the half integer. Yeah. So we still go between minus 24 and 24, but now by step of 1/2. So 0, 1/2, 1, 3/2, so on and so forth. If we do that, so you could do it as well on the circle, which means that you would also include this point, you take this one, you include this one, you keep this one, you add this one, you keep this one, so on and so forth. Yeah, you could do that. We would need to look at what happens with pi over 12. And the same story, yes, so that's 3 pi over 12. 3 pi over 12 is pi over 4. Correct? Pi over 4 is actually easy and straightforward, and it's important to remember it, because the sine of pi over 4 is equal to the cosine of pi over 4, because this is the diagonal. Pi over 4 is 45 degrees, right? So we've got the same angle here and the same angle here, which means the sine and cosine are the same. In which case, I let you do it, but with Pythagoras, you get right away that the sine and the cos are equal, and they are both equal to square root of 2 over 2 this time. So at least this point we have. We will need this one, and then they repeat. So to find the sine of pi over 12, there is also a trick that you can look in the exercise and try to work it out by yourself. You can discretize a vector like this. You can look at the overlap of the sine and the cos, so pi over 12 this time, and you will still find that they are orthogonal. So this is a nice result. It looks correct. We are making the thing more precise. We find the same result. The sine and cosine don't see each other. If we look, however, at the norm, we would find this time that the sine of pi over 12 is equal to the square root, because I'm taking at the norm, and for the sine, it will become the square root of 48. While for the cosine, we would find that this is the square root of 49. So as before, the square root, the cosine, is larger than by 1 point below the square root. Yeah, because this we can write this at 2 times 24, and this one is 2 times 24 plus 1. That's the extra bit that we get from our sampling with a discrete grid, our cosine. If we do it with an even thinner mesh, and then we start to go towards this idea, as you could imagine, through a limiting process, we are taking always and always thinner grid, like we could take 10 points, rather than going by steps of 1/2, we go by steps of 1/10. Yeah? So here I put 1/10 now. So I've got a very thin grid, which means that now I'm really sampling my sine with a lot of resolution, a lot of accuracy. So again, something that the computer will be really good at doing, yeah, to take a lot of points. And then I take 1 over 100, 1 over 1,000, 1 over 10 million, and it becomes really, really lot of points. So our vector, which before was 49 and then 97, now it will become millions of components. And in the limit of zero gap, we go to an infinite size vector. So that's actually the point at which it becomes a real, really abstract object, not an n-dimensional vector, which is by itself not too new. It becomes new when we take an infinite number of points. There we've got an infinite column. And it starts to be a bit different than Rn, yeah? Maybe we could even call it like this, R infinity. So that's a function, that's something that we could be probing, let's say, for even a countable set. It has to be countable, yeah, because I have the first, the second, the fourth. It could be centered at zero, and I get the first positive, first negative, second negative, and go infinity for the positive and infinity for the negative. But it has to be countable. But still, that's good enough sampling of our functions for all practical purposes. And provided that the finite sum, which become infinite series, do converge, we can apply all these concepts and measure the norms and so forth. So let's see what would happen if we take 100 points. For 100 points, I will write it in this color, in blue. The sine will become the square root of 480, which is the square root of 10 times 48. 10 times 48, that's with 100 points, I believe. And here I will get 481, so the same as before, is 10 times 48 plus 1. Okay, so always this plus 1 for the cosine aspect. So let's try to see. Let's try to see what is the common thing to all this. Where does this 24 happen? What we are doing, really, when we define the vector in this way, getting there, when we are writing the sine pi over 6 function, yeah? So I could put the x to remember it's a function. What we are looking is, we'll start at a, which is minus 24, we'll finish at b, which in our case is 24, but it doesn't have to be, and I'm trying to generalize the whole idea. Let's say that, well, at least in our case, we have zero in the beginning. What we are doing is that we are sampling like this, yeah? We are taking plus k and with the delta step, delta, and this delta step is b minus a divided by our number of points, okay? So when k is equal to zero, we are at a, and when k is equal to n, we've got a plus b minus a, we are there. Okay, so in n plus 1, n plus 1 to include the 0, n plus 1 point of our grid, we are describing our discretization of our mesh. And we are sampling the value of our function, which is whatever. Whatever is our function, like this, yeah, we are looking at the value that are intercepted by our grid. We are making a vector out of this. We are putting this n plus 1 point in a column vector. We can take the grid smaller and smaller, and we define this. So what we find is that the norm of this vector increases with the number of points in this way. It was increasing. I will have to take the square root at the end. So it was b minus a, and it was increasing proportionally to the number of points. Yeah. So what we should do is try to normalize it. Try to divide. If we double the number of points, we should divide the length of our vector, so that remains the same. Okay. We should try to precisely normalize it, to stabilize the process. So the way to do this actually is to include this normalization there. We have to divide by b minus a divided by n. You can check that before this b minus a was 48. So divided by the number of points that we took, which was it was 48 plus 1, I believe, 2 times 24 plus 1, 49. That's our delta step. And that's the quantity which we try to keep constant. Or at least if we define it like this, and there's a sum there, for k goes from 0 to n, there is a sum that makes it that this is the sum which is independent, or it will converge actually, so we'll have to take the limit at the end of the day. Let's not put the square root, let's put the square there. Because like this we can focus on the limit, and put this here, we can put the limit, so when n goes to infinity. Okay, so this will change less and less, it will converge to something, which was the case indeed, because if we divide by these quantities, by the number of points, we have a square root of 24 and square root of 25. Then for the second one, we have square root of 48. Where did I put it? We have square root of 48. So this will have to divide by 2 inside the square root before we take the square root. Yeah. So we have to divide by square root of 2. So that's exactly square root of 24 again, once normalized. Here it's not a square root of 25 as before, it's square root of 49 divided by 2. Yeah? So it's a bit smaller. So indeed, the part which is different, the cosine, changed. The part that was the same, regardless of the grid, it doesn't change. That's good. The same with 480. Yeah? Where is my 480? Must be below. When I take the grid of 100 points, why is it? I don't see it right away. Well, I can write it again, doesn't matter. Okay, so it was 480, so divided by 10, by 20, and that brings us back to 24, and the other was 481 divided by 20. And that brings us to something which is very close to 24, a bit in excess. But the error is smaller and smaller because our delta step is smaller. So so that's the way to define the square. This quantity we will see again in our next lecture. That's an important thing that corresponds actually to a measure of the area below the curve, right? This we will come to see it as a Riemann sum. And in the limit, the infinite sum, the infinite addition of this Riemann sum, it becomes a Riemann integral. In which case, when our function now is a real function of x, like the sine, we don't write it like this, we write it like this. We have this special notation where we put below and above the sine the boundary where we integrate, where we add the quantities. And here, this sign here, it is the Leibniz sign for the summation of something which is continuous. Okay. So now we don't have the vector with discrete slot to put the value of the functions. We really take all the values. And the way that we are looking at it there is to look at this quantity. So actually, I should put the square there. Sorry. This is the square. And the norm of our functions. So I will write it again for a function f. When we make the scalar product of f with itself, or we are making this product of, sorry, I will write it like this, transpose, so the stable product of f with itself, so that's the good notation for it, this becomes the f squared dx. between A and B, which are the boundaries of the space of functions in which we are working. Now, if you are looking at this scalar product between two functions that are different, like the sine and cosine, then this is the product of fj. If I would write everything, yeah, that's f of x dx, a, b, and this one is f of x, g of x, dx. So here we are making the product between this function f and g, and that's what makes the overlap. So to make the integral of the product, or the overlap, gives us this scalar product of the two functions, of our two abstract vectors. So if we come back at the beginning, at the very beginning, to the very, very abstract, more abstract than a sine object, we can look at things like this. You can look at what is the overlap between the live cat and the dead cat. And then this is zero. They are orthogonal, just like the sine and cosine are zero, which means they describe completely different things. As you might expect, one describes life, the other describes death. Okay. And once you know this, and other things like a live cat with itself is equal to one, which means that it is basically the same object, yeah, the same one, is the same quantity, and the same as well for the dead cat. The dead cat with itself is equal to one. Then you can compute things like this. You can compute, I will copy it because I'm not sure I can repeat this this type of things. You can ask what is the scalar product or the overlap between the live cat and the Schrödinger cat. And this we can compute this time. Okay, this is something that we can compute because we can remember that there is the overlap thing. I copy this. So we're asking again, what is this quantity? That's what we're asking. And this quantity I can distribute there. I can put it there. Now we are doing algebra with this vector. Okay. And algebra with this abstract vector works like the algebra that we know, which means that we can distribute it. So I can take this object and put it inside the sum. I will do it now by copying it. I copy this object. I want it. I'm not copying it well. Sorry. Okay, I will draw it again. So I can put it inside there and there. Okay, so now this one is inside. So I can put the parentheses to include it. That's one over square root of two. Yeah. And then this we said is equal to 1, that's the overlap of the live cat with itself, and this is 0, that's the overlap of the live cat with the dead cat, and they are perpendicular. The live cat doesn't see the dead cat, but the live cat sees itself completely. So what we get is that the overlap of the live cat with the Schrödinger cat is equal to 1 over square root of 2. So this 1 over square root of 2, I let you check, is there to normalize the state, which means that the length of the Schrödinger cat, if you look at the overlap of the Schrödinger cat with itself, with this rule there, that live is 1, dead is 1, live dead is 0, it shows you that if you need to have 1 over square root of 2 so that the thing is normalized. Again, we leave it to proper course of quantum mechanics to explain the physical meaning of this. What I want to insist on here is this generalization of the rules of algebra and of vector addition and real scaling and scalar product to sophisticated abstract object that can be, well, sine or cosine, and they are already different from the vectors you know because they are not n-dimensional, they are the limit of n-dimensional, so they are infinite size vector, they are continuous function. In this sense, this is an abstract object. Sine and cosine is still fine, but it could be more complicated stuff. We could do algebra with drawing, bananas, colors, cats, whatever. Okay, so it's unfamiliar what we are discussing today, it's a bit new. But it just asks you, it's demanding you to make this effort of accepting that the rules that we know very well, these rules of algebra, the easy rules on top of that, because it's linear algebra, so of adding things or making scalar product or distributing in the parentheses. So the most simplest rule of algebra, we can apply it to more complicated or sophisticated objects. So because we don't like complicated or sophisticated, we call them abstract. And this is abstract algebra or abstract vector space. Abstract, it really means this. It means that you cannot put your fingers right on all the components of the things, right? The object is kind of complicated. And this we illustrate it by putting a drawing of a cat. But complicated in the sense that the nature of the object cannot be reduced to a few numbers. it can involve a lot of details, like the weight of the cat, the age of the cat, the details of the cats, lots of things that might not be relevant for our calculations. But it refers to the object itself. When we describe the physical reality, the object with which we are making the calculation can be complicated object. This sounds abstract, because there is a lot to it. But we don't look at all this complication in detail. We just encapsulate it and we put it in this notation of Dirac, the diskette. And like this, we can do easy, simple linear algebra using the simple rules. Okay, so it's really unfamiliar, and as everything in familiar at first, you're a bit surprised, but once you understand the idea, it's really simple to work with it. So please accept it, try to get familiar with it. I'll conclude by telling you why this name of the cat. For this, so let's put a psi again because I don't want to draw a cat. Or the so we call that the dual vector or the dual object. When we go in more detail, the one which consists, if we discretize a complicated object, we discretize it in a big vector of n components. So the column becomes a transpose conjugated is a complex line, and that becomes the bra and the cat. Why? Because this scalar product like this. The one we started with, the one that is familiar with n-dimensional object, like this one. Yeah, this one. The mathematician, they have a notation for that. They write it like this, UV, or over like this, in parentheses. Yeah, there are different notations depending on the various books or authors that deal with them. And this they call a bracket. Yeah, that's a bracket, or we could put like this, in a different notation, a bracket. So now you see why our really whimsical, really clever Dirac used this notation. Because when you bring a ket together with a bra, you make the product in this way, you get a bracket. That's the mathematical operation of the mathematician. But instead of using this notation, when we use the more straightforward one that we are really like stucking them together. Yeah. So we transform. Or he took advantage of the notation to do something which has a nice that maps nicely, that corresponds nicely to the mathematical operation which is involved. This again corresponds for the continuous function to making the integral of the overlap. Or if there would be a discretized finite vector, that would be the sum of the component. Okay, where n could even be going to infinity if you would make an infinite discretized thing. And all this is captured by this simple concept. Yeah, so this is what we call an overlap, or mathematician would call that an inner product. For us, it would be this bracket, this overlap, this scalar product between two vectors. Okay, so that's the length of our abstract object. Now we can speak of the length of a cat state in quantum mechanics. We'll be dealing, for the rest of our lectures in mathematics, we'll be dealing with functions mainly. So our vectors, our abstract vectors, will be functions, discretized or not. If they're not discretized, we'll be using this integral. If they're discretized, we'll be using sums. And then we'll, by practicing, we'll hopefully become more and more familiar with this abstract operation, which means easy operation with sophisticated objects.